But then this little voice in my head kept going. Instead of just saying rejoicing with you, it said, but my family can out-burp your family any day of the week.
Welcome to the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. I'm your host, Scott Moore. Thanks for joining us today. Good morning, Steve. How are you today?
I'm recovering. How are you?
I'm good. I got a long day ahead of me, but it should be good.
Amen. What's going to make it good?
My attitude. That's about all I got at this point.
Yeah, that's a good response. What'd you do for Labor Day?
My boys came home from college and we hung out. They played some games. We didn't do much, but had a good time being together. So
nice.
Yeah. How about you?
This was our annual trip up to the lake with one, two, three, four or five families.
Ooh.
Papa, let's go for a ride on the golf cart. Can I be first?
Yeah. You need a vacation from that, don't you?
I do. I am having even trouble seeing the screen on my computer this morning.
Nice.
But it was awesome. I just kept thinking back to all the things. I was kayaking with the kids and we were, of course, golf carting. But problem was, is that it rained for over half of the time. So,
ugh.
Yeah, a little tricky.
Bummer.
Okay, let's jump in. Father, thank you for bringing us through another week since we've been together on this podcast. Thank you for all that you've done for each of us. Thank you for all that you're doing for the world. It looks up and down, but I believe from your perspective, it's a straight line from creation to the consummation. You've got everything under control. To help us today as we consider our topic, that you'll draw near to us, encourage each of our hearts in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, so today we're going to talk about the burp.
The burp?
That's a great response.
Please explain.
When I was 12 years old, my mom and dad took my two brothers and myself downtown Pittsburgh to watch the movie The Sound of Music. That's when it came out. Now, we were generally what we would call a drive-in theater family. That's all we could afford. We were middle class, maybe a little lower middle class, and we rarely went to movie theaters. But, you know, for $2 a car, we could all pile into our station wagon, and my brothers and I would have our pillows in the back, and you put the whole thing down flat, and we'd take our own food because we couldn't afford the snack bar, you know, so we'd eat our own popcorn and Kool-Aid. But my mom thought that this was a special movie. And this was going to be a special event. So the five of us went to downtown Pittsburgh and saw Sound of Music at the Warner Theater. And I remember coming out of the theater, and I loved the movie. And my mom got us all together, and we were on the steps. And she said, I wish we could have a family like that. I never lost that. I'd forgotten it until I was doing some counseling slash therapy with a man one time. And he just kept asking deep and probing questions. And he said, you know, why do you have such a passion for the family? And as he kept asking questions, I had answers, but he kept going deeper. And at one point he said, is there anything else you think that would contribute to this? And I thought, and I paused, and I thought, that experience right there on the steps of the Warner Theater. But I do have a great desire for families, and I had one for my own family. I wanted to be like The Sound of Music. I wanted to be like a group of people that liked each other, that did things together. Of course, in The Sound of Music, it's about music. And they sang together. They performed together. And if you know their history, they even came to America and made a living moving around the country singing. Well, with that background, let me go a little further. When I first started going to homeschool conferences, it wasn't so much about the education that attracted me. It was about the families that I was meeting. Lovely families, large families, families who would often start the conference by standing up on the stage and singing a song together. And these particular families normally had a great abundance of children who dressed similarly. Oftentimes they played musical instruments, or at least several of them did, while the rest of them sang. And there'd be like 8 or 9 kids. The more you learned about this family, you found out they also raised goats. They made their own clothes. I'm just kidding. But it seemed like they just were an ideal family. And then they homeschool magazines would take pictures of these families and put them on their covers. So they would sit in your home on the coffee table. You would see these homeschool magazines with a picture of a lovely family on the front.
Just sitting there mocking you, aren't they?
They were. Because, you know, I finally gave in and I bought 6 recorders. Nice. And I thought, we're going to be the Von Demme Family Recorder Players. And I took home those 6 recorders because I went to a lot of conferences. And I finally yielded to the pressure. We're going to be the family that plays the recorders together. We're going to have costumes. Anyway, I didn't go that far, but I was just thinking, let's play the recorders together. I'd played it in elementary school. My wife had played it. Can't be that tough. But then it lasted about 2 weeks. And I went back into feeling like I will never be the Von Trapp family singers. And you know, you start beating yourself up. And then over the years, you continue to see these families and you wish you'd made your children keep playing the piano and all those musical instruments that they started and never finished. And I would call that my normal state of semi-condemnation, where no matter what I did, just wasn't enough. And sadly, I lived that way for a long time. But we gave up on the recorders after about 2 weeks. I have lots of good ideas. My wife was the one that usually carried through stuff, but this one didn't stick. I asked the boys one time, I said, whatever happened to those recorders? And they looked at me and they said, we made swords out of them.
Nice.
I thought, this is what boys do. They make military implements out of anything. You give a little baby boy a graham cracker, and he eats it around the edges and makes a pistol out of it. But anyway, so this is what we had. We had boys. And I really did. I kind of beat myself up because not only did I have to see these families at conferences, like you said, I had to look at their pictures on the magazines. And they're just sitting there going, you know, shaking their finger. Anyway, over the years, God was working in my heart a wonderful message. And I didn't know it at the time, but my third son and I, Joseph, went to a conference one night. I was going to speak in the morning, and the night before, family stands up. They all play a musical instrument. They're dressed really nicely. And instead of beating myself up, I looked at them and I thought, praise the Lord. I rejoice with you. If you can pull it off, good for you. And by the way, that's what the Bible says. Rejoice with those that can pull this stuff off. Rejoice with those that rejoice. And so I thought, okay, good for you. But then this little voice in my head kept going. Instead of just saying rejoicing with you, it said, but my family can out-burp your family any day of the week.
Nice. I like it.
Because my third son can burp the entire alphabet in one burp.
Wow.
Yeah. I haven't heard it. I don't want to hear it. I think it's kind of gross. But the message, this is God. This is so God. God's all over this because God was working in my heart and he was making me see that he didn't design me to be the Von Trapps. He designed me to be the Demmes. And we don't sing together. We just spent Labor Day together. All of our kids and grandkids and niece and her family. How many families? About five families. There was 19 people because one of the girls was sick. All together. We never sang the whole time. Nobody pulled out an instrument. But we did play cards. We kayaked. We went for hikes. We rode golf carts. My wife created a mini golf course on the front lawn. And we just did our thing. What is our thing? I don't know, but we just did it. And it's okay. And what God was telling me is, Steve, I didn't design you to be the Von Trapps or those families on those magazines. I designed your family to be your family. And I heard somebody say one time, and I wrote it in my Bible, comparison is the enemy of vision. And it's really important that we don't compare ourselves to other families, but we develop a vision for our own family. We're going to be the Demmes, and the Demmes do things differently than the Moores, who do things differently than the Wilsons and the St. Johns. We just are. And that's a testament to God's creative design. He makes not only each of us different, each of our families he makes different. And instead of trying to pattern ourselves after other families, not that we can't learn things from them, but just develop a vision for our own family. And that's it. And it was such a great release when he said, you know, my family can outburp yours. It was kind of a combination of me and God, and it was all together, but it was a wonderful message. Don't compare yourself to others. Just be who God designed you to be. Okay. Great message. Let me keep going. So over the years, I would share this at conferences, and I was in Massachusetts several years later, and I told what I just related here. And afterwards, a grandmother and grandfather and their daughter and their three granddaughters came walking up the aisle towards me as I was leaving the room. She introduced herself, and it was the grandmother that introduced herself. Which, by the way, I thought it was fantastic having grandparents at the homeschool conference because they need to get a vision for what parents are trying to do too, so that we can all be on the same page. So anyway, this lady comes up and she said, I'm one of the Von Trapp family children. And of course I, really? Because I knew all the children. Are you Liesl? She goes, no. After Georg married Maria, they had a couple more daughters. I was one of those daughters. So she wasn't in the movie. She was a result of the movie. And then she went on to say, and she had six daughters. And of course, the one that she was with was homeschooling her three daughters. And she said, not only did I have six daughters, I taught them all how to play the recorder.
Nice.
So their family used to play the recorders together. And here was Maria Von Trapp's daughter telling me this after I had just shared about what a great impact the sound of music had had on my life, but then how it had actually led to me trying to be the Von Trapps, et cetera. And here she was standing in front of me. And it was awesome. It was full circle. And the next morning, we were all apparently staying at the same hotel or else parking nearby, but you had to walk across the street to get to the convention center. So we were at the light, and I noticed this woman and her husband were standing right in front of me. So I started singing. Climb every mountain, or I don't remember which one I sang. Johnny and I, my son with Downs, we used to have a CD with all the Sound of Music songs on it. And I had a convertible and we would put that on And we would drive down the road singing to the top of our lungs all the songs. So I know most of the songs. Might have been The Hills Are Alive. Anyway, she turned around and she popped me one. I mean, it was a good thump right in my chest. She said, "Stop it." And I said, "Why?" She goes, "I don't want everybody coming up and asking me questions about my mother. I'm just here to go to the conference." But she did it with a twinkle in her eye. But it was a good thump. I like spunk. And I laughed and laughed. And so we walked across the street when the light changed. And as we're walking along the edge, it opened up. It was like around the convention center. I started singing again. I said, "High on a hill is a lonely goat herd. Lay ho, lay ho, lay ho." And her husband looked at me and he said, "You're going to be a lonely goat herd. You keep singing that song." And again, I just cracked up again and we all grinned and we walked to the convention together. But I'm just so blessed by that opportunity to not only share at the conference and to meet a bunch of lovely people, but to meet Maria von Trapp's daughter and sing with her at the Worcester Convention Center.
Not many people can that? Say that.
Yeah, exactly.
That's very cool. Well, I think you probably have helped a lot of people over the years, because I know there are plenty of homeschool families who still feel like they need to be the von Trapps. It's a real thing. Like they feel like they have to sew their own clothes and make their own wheat, and you know, yeah. it's a
fact, pressure. And that's what I try to do. And I remember being at one conference in Illinois, and I shared that story and other things where I dropped the ball and how God had met us and different things, just being very vulnerable. And I had a counselor come up to me. I didn't know who he was, but he came up to me and he said, "Thank you for that message." He says, "I probably won't have any work this week." I said, but he was smiling. I said, "What do you mean?" He says, "I'm a counselor. And normally after these homeschool conferences, I have people lined up at my door needing help because they feel so condemned because they're not measuring up to what they think is an ideal family."
Wow.
It's not just homeschoolers. It's, we all have this picture in our head, what we should do. And he said, "Thank you. Thank you. Thank you." Isn't that good?
Yeah.
So sorry about his business, but I'm glad. And that the message of no condemnation, be who God designed you to be. Don't measure yourself by anybody else. And that's really Romans 8:1, I think, should be on every refrigerator. Here it is. "There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus." No condemnation. And we have an enemy, and one of his names is Accuser. He's the accuser of the brethren, says this in Revelation. And just think of that little sneering accusations that are coming from the pit. "Oh, you'll never be this. Oh, you can't do this. Oh, you can't." No, that's from the pit. God is on our team. God says, "Hey, here's my kid. I love you to pieces." So two different messages. Jesus says, no condemnation. Be who I designed you to be. The devil says, lots of condemnation. See if I can get you to stop trying to be who God designed you to be.
Tell you what, that verse is really helpful in parenting for me, at least. I've had a couple of times when my kids, as they've gotten older, have confessed some sin to me, and I can tell they've, you know, in a couple of specific occasions, I could tell that they were looking to see if I was going to condemn them or not. And I quoted that verse to them and just said, "There's no condemnation. If Jesus isn't condemning you, neither am I."
Well done. Well done, Dad. You know, I noticed that thing. You remember where Jesus was kneeling down and told him that he that's without sin cast the first stone?
Yeah.
You remember who the guys were that left right away? The old guys.
The old guys, yep.
Because when you're young, you don't know as much. When you're older, I got lots of reasons not to be throwing stones. Yeah.
Yep.
Amen. Well, let's pray. Father, thank you for this message that you taught me over a period of many years just to be who you designed me to be and not to be somebody else. I'm sure there's still probably parts of me that does that, but I pray that you will help me to just embrace your design for me and for my family. Help us to be who you designed us to be. And all who are listening, I pray that you'll deliver us from condemnation, deliver us from accusations, and help us to hear the gentle, affirming voice of the Spirit saying, I have loved you with an everlasting love, and there is no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. Wash us afresh with that message today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. And that's our show for this week, folks. Thanks for joining us for the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. If you have a question for the show, email Steve at spdemme@gmail.com. If you have a question for me, you can reach me at scott@unsocializedmedia.com. Thanks for joining us. Have a great week.